message on the occasion of the 48th anniversary of the independence of Barbados. It is with humble appreciation and gratitude that I bring greetings to you on behalf of our country, Barbados, and the country team here at Toronto. This period of celebration provides an opportunity for us to reflect on the events of the past year and to give thanks to the Almighty God for His goodness and mercy toward us, toward our adopted home here, Canada, toward our country, Barbados. The past year brought with it many challenges for Barbados and for our country team. Barbados continues to cope with climate change, promoting sustainable development, managing the development of the country's infrastructure, and finding ways of improving our social and health services, while putting systems in place to overcome the economic downturn our country and the world have experienced. The respective agencies within the consulate have shown a high degree of resilience to overcome the challenges which have emerged despite the cutbacks to their budgets. Through it all, we were able to report progress. Barbadians living in Canada through their organizations and also individually continue to demonstrate a love for the land of their birth in a variety of ways, by providing funds for scholarship and funds raised through their many activities. They also express that love by their remittances by their frequent visits to their country in Barbados and to their relatives and friends back home. I will be seeking to encourage them to take advantage of the investment opportunities which become available through the issue of government saving bonds. We remain hopeful that the combined efforts of the government and private sector, supported by the continued commitment and dedication of the mission here in Canada and the members of the diaspora community, will redound to the benefit of our beloved country, Barbados. The theme chosen for this year, Hope, Healing and Strength Through Unity, is therefore timely and appropriate. As we continue to depend on the unfailing hands of God and the collective wisdom of our leaders to create a pathway of progress for our people, let us resolve to work together toward reflecting the pride of nationhood. Let us look to the future with confidence, with the knowledge that the Lord has been the people's guide, and with the assurance that with Him on our side, we will have nothing to fear. May God bless our country as we wish everyone happy 48th anniversary.
Fellow Barbadians, please join me in saying the National Pledge. I pledge allegiance to my country, Barbados, and to my flag, to uphold and defend their honor, and by my living, to do credit to my nation wherever I go.
Thank you very much. Good morning to all.
Good morning.
The Mr. Council, members of the Caribbean Consular Corps, I recognize our friends from Guyana, Jamaica, St. Kitts and Nevis, St. Lucia, Grenada, Antigua. I want to say thanks for braving this nice weather we are in this morning. It's not too treacherous, so I feel good about it. Freddie, I'm happy that we can stand, but if some of us will sit, we will not be able to get back up. I want to thank you very much, Inspector Strobel. Thank you very much for coming. And all you wonderful Barbadians and Barbadian friends, and especially the staff of the council here. Let me see you, but you raised your hand, the staff. Oh, look at them, look. Wonderful. Thanks for coming out and supporting your wonderful country, Barbados. I am not going to be long because Jennifer, in her prayer, would have said a half of what I wanted to say. And therefore, I want to say to you that I bring greetings to you on the occasion of the 40th anniversary of Barbados. And I do so on behalf of Team Barbados at the consulate, and also on behalf of all Barbadians living in Canada and in Barbados. This period of celebration provides an opportunity for us to reflect on the events of the past year and to give thanks to the Almighty God for His goodness and His mercies toward us. toward our adopted country here in Canada and toward Barbados. Barbadians living here in Canada, through your various organizations and individually, you continue to demonstrate that love for the country, the land of your birth. You've done that again this morning by your presence here. And I want to thank you very much. You continue to do it in a variety of ways. We in Barbados and here in the consulate remain hopeful that through the combined efforts of government and the private sector and those committed to the development of the country will continue to support it. And I'm looking forward to the members of the diaspora community to do their utmost to ensure that what Jennifer prayed for and prayed about will redound to the benefit of the country. The theme chosen for this year said it says hope, healing, and strength through unity. And Jennifer, I'm sure you, if you didn't even have an idea of what the theme was, you prayed for that strength through unity. And I want to thank you and thank all of you as we continue to depend on the unfailing hands of God and the collective wisdom of our leaders to create a pathway for the progress of our people. Let us resolve to work together toward reflecting the pride of nationhood. Let us look toward the future with confidence, with the knowledge that the Lord has been the people's guide, as in the words of the national anthem. And with Him on the people's side, we have no doubt or fear. Again, let me thank you. And when you get back to the office, I will have a little bit more to say as far as the message from the Prime Minister is concerned. But I heard a message from him this morning saying, if it's very cold, don't read the message. Wait till you get back inside and do it. So happy 40th anniversary to our beloved country Barbados and to all Barbadians living in Canada. God bless you. See you back at the office shortly.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
On behalf of the government of Barbados and the people of Barbados, we'd like to thank all of you for joining us in celebrating our 48th anniversary of our country, Barbados. Allow me to thank specially our Council General for bringing the message or the remarks of benevolence of the country. Thank you all, leaders of the Barbados Associations, members of the diaspora, the Councilor Corps, the members of staff of the Council, Consulate of Barbados, and all of you, we thank you specially for being here with us. And even in this cold, I know it must be heartwarming to see all of you. And above all, thank God who has prospered our way and led us so far. Thank you.
With those last few words, then we invite you to have fellowship with us at the consulate. It's nicer and warmer there. Thank you.
Again, for gracing us with your presence. I am deliberately slow because I cannot slow down, take my time, and get out and talk. Maybe over there, we kind of fast track so that we could get away from that nice, cool weather that we experience. Let's welcome Inspector Stobel again with a round of applause. Thank you very much, sir. And we have here on my left the Consul General for St. Kitts, Nevis. Thank you very much for being here with us. Let me say how happy I am this morning to be able to stand before you and to address you. Last year, it was, I don't remember how it was last year, if it was cold like this last year. Was it? You remember, you can still, you can still feel it? Wow. All right, this morning and last night when I saw the weatherman, I said, that weatherman, he told us it's going to be warm, sunny in the morning, but of course with a minus temperature. And then I said, we're good, we have sun. Don't mind the cold. But then, when I came out of the office and made my way across, I saw all cloud. And I said, wow, that weatherman hide me from Barbados. Because in Barbados, when the weatherman tells you it's going to be sunny and warm, you have to walk with your umbrella sometimes. But it was good over there, and I want to thank you very much for braving that.
It was colder last year.
All right, you remembered very well. You know, you can always trust the seniors to remember. I went to a function only on Wednesday over in Kitchener, and there was a lady there who was celebrating 100 years, Mrs. Thorne from Barbados. And she could remember poems from the time she was a toddler. But of course, she almost beat me to it because I could remember from the day I was born. How many of you can remember that? My mother kept me informed about that, you know. My mother kept me informed. My mother gave me commentary from the, she said it was a Sunday night, 7:30. I told the nurse I'm ready. The nurse said, no, you're not quite ready. She said, go get the doctor. He was in the Gemma's Lane Hospital there, the old hospital. And the doctor didn't come on time. And when they heard me cry out, I remember distinctly that sound. And I there was out into the world on my own. And then that's why my mother tells me that of all of her 10 children, I was always the most independent, because nobody helped me out. Nobody slapped me to cry. I came out by myself. Happy independence to all of you. Today we have a number of wonderful things for you. Dolores and Gloria and her people. But Gloria has made, not Gloria, it's Evelyn, that cake in the middle there, has made a cake with all the 11 parishes there. I am sure that I am the only person here from St. Thomas. I was born in St. Peter, so I will cut
I
a piece.
I was born in St. Thomas.
Oh, Lord have mercy. See, I was hoping that I'm the only one from St. Thomas that I would get the St. Thomas piece. It looks as though now I have to share it with you. But that cake, we're going to be slicing it up according to our parish and eating as much as we can. While you eat that cake, remember the story of the 5,000, when Jesus fed the 5,000. Make sure we have basketful left from that cake. And the Lord, of course, and her team, they have made some wonderful Barbadian wear there. Coconut bread, pone, turnovers, conkeys are there, fish cakes, the whole works right here. So you feel good about that. And of course, we have the blue and yellow napkins as well. And I feel happy about that. And then this week, because we wanted to give an extra touch to things Barbadian, we invited a number of Barbadian artists and photographers to come. There are two of them here. Courtney, the Barbadian photographer, is here. And then there is Alvin Cummins here. And we're going to be getting them right shortly. We're going to invite, I'm going to introduce them, and then I'm going to invite Alex to say a few words on behalf of Alvin Cummins, who has three books on display. And of course, we have two other persons here, and they are going to tell you something about their book. We're not going to be very long. We're going to give you a chance to buy the books as well. Please patronize those authors and the photographers and art people on display, and that gives them encouragement to really continue to do things. I am not an artist myself. I never did well at school in art. Always got low marks for art. I told somebody a few months ago that when I was a little boy at school, and they brought this, I had a slate, and you know those bits of slate and pencils that you were supposed to draw something on the slate, and I couldn't get none drawn. Throw water on the slate. I mean, the teacher asked what happened. He said, well, I was trying to do cricket, but the rain washed out play. So, that chance, you know that.
Before we get going further, I'm going to ask us that we should sing one verse and chorus of the national anthem. Lenore, start us again. Let's stand. One verse and chorus, first verse and chorus of the national anthem.
In plenty and in time of need, when this fair land was young, our grateful fathers sowed the seed from which our pride is sprung, a pride that makes no wanton boast of what it has withstood, that binds our hearts from coast to coast, the pride of nationhood.
My book is a biography of my late husband, Eric Murray, who was a Barbadian, who came to Canada in the early 60s. And why you might need to read this book is that it really brings the story of that time from Barbados to Canada. It tells you about the immigration process. It tells you about his work in Barbados and his work in Canada. He was a journalist and he's done a lot of work in those short years. Eventually he died of leukemia, but during those years he did his best. And I remembered when he was ill and thought he would die, he said, you know, I've done everything that I wanted to do. So here's the book, Son of Barbados. And again, it gives you the story of his life. And it also involved the life of the family, my two daughters and I. His journey to Ottawa and back. We lived in Ottawa for 4 years. He did journalism in Ottawa as well. And there are a couple of poems in here. One of my friends said that it is not really a romance book, but in the book there's lots of romance, so you might want to find that page. That tells a story of our lives back in Barbados, and that started from the time he was 7 years old and I was 5. We actually met at primary school. So here's the book, the soft cover, $20, hard cover, $25. And you'd have something that reminds you of Barbados from that time until. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. I am hoping, just tell me the page that captures when you all first met. You said 5 and 7. That's a good page.
Yes.
That's really good. I can't remember my wife and I met. But I hope that you had that, those words in there, the first words, the nice, nice poems.
I do.
You have it?
Yeah.
Nice. Like, my heart is like a cabbage, I think. Yeah. You know, nowadays the people don't write no foolishness like that. You know?
I have the courtship as well.
My, you have it?
Yeah, my parents were involved. I always used to tell my husband he was courting my dad, not me.
Wow.
Because he did. He really courted my dad first.
You know, in our days, he did?
Yeah, he did.
He court your dad?
Yeah.
Of course, you had to get permission from the dad.
Yeah.
In those days, you had to get permission from the old man and the old lady. Because if you didn't get the permission, you're in trouble. But in those days, like when we were teens and growing and writing poems to the girls, my heart is like a cabbage divided into two. The leaves I give to others. No, not now. I know a fellow who wrote that to his girlfriend, and she wrote him back and said, look, my heart is like a heifer divided into two. The meat I give to others and the horns I give to you. You can't write the kind of things nobody like that now. Alex, I'm going to invite you to speak on behalf and introduce the book from Alvin.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone, and thanks again for coming. And I just want to just say that Alvin is a tremendously gifted writer. I don't know if most of you know, I was a teacher for like 30 years, and I'm now retired. And I think that his books should be in all the schools in Barbados, and even here in Toronto, in the secondary schools for sure. And he's written 3 novels so far, The Wind Also Listens, and of course, The Royal Palms Are Dying. And I know some of my friends here read The Royal Palms Are Dying. They read it and they thought it was fantastic with their book club and so on. So you definitely want to get these books at some point. And the latest one is one that could be a little bit controversial. And it's called Yeshua, also a.k.a. Jesus the Nazarene. And a great read. I read the manuscript about 2 years ago, so the book is out now. Alvin was going to launch it in Barbados early this year, but he got ill, and he came here for treatment. And I'm so happy that he's coming along quite nicely. All I'm going to say is that Alvin, of course, has been writing seriously since 1985. He was born in Barbados and has lived, studied, and worked in Jamaica, New York, Toronto, Andorra, Qatar, in the Arabian Gulf. He recently completed his studies leading to a philosophy in microbiology, actually not that recently, a few years ago, in microbiology. And he's also been an actor on stage, of course, and in television, and even doing some radio dramas. He's a writer of a number of literary works in various genres, 4 plays, The Homecoming, 3 Women, Aija, and Jaja, King of Opobo, 3 musicals, East Side, West Side, Emerton, and Redemption, and of course the novels I told you about. So I think that Trevor Marshall, a noted historian in Barbados, says that that Yeshua, the latest novel, reads more like reality than fiction. And he has me here. I didn't even know this until I got the actual book, that he has a quote from me. I had written some stuff surrounding the manuscript. And he said, I said, it's written in an easy, clear, descriptive style, and it has made me examine my Christian values more closely. Because the beautiful thing about this book is that there's lots of notes at the back and so on. So it's a very interesting book, even if you are not Christian. And a lot of work with it from the Dead Sea Scrolls. He did a lot of research. So I'm really impressed with his research. So I would like to introduce you to Alvin Cummins, a good man. And a good writer.
Thank you, Alex. Thank you,
Mr. Ben.
And thank you to the staff at Consul General's office. My 3 books are basically in 3 different genres. The Wind Also Listens is part autobiographical, but it was written to let the young people know what happened to Barbados or happened in Barbados or what Barbados was like in the 40s, 50s, 60s, etc. It's called The Wind Also Listens because I feel that the wind is animated. Things in nature are very close to us. And the wind hears everything that goes on. And the wind passes that message to other people and to other places. In other words, in 1937, we had riots in Bridgetown. But the people in St. Lucie knew about the riots without any telephone or anything like that, but they knew. And they knew what went on. And The Wind Also Listens looks at the lives of 5 Barbadians who, for various reasons and through various methods, escaped from the society that existed at that time. I want to read a couple of brief passages from this book. I started it in 1970 when I was at Mona studying, but I never completed it till around 1996 because I put it down, got on with the life here in Canada to achieve the American dream. We're in Canada, but we want to achieve the American dream. So I put it down for a while. The Royal Palms Are Dying is really a sequel to The Wind Also Listens. So I would advise you to buy The Wind Also Listens, or to read The Wind Also Listens first, then read The Royal Palms Are Dying, because the characters that are in The Wind Also Listens appear in The Royal Palms. So if you read The Royal Palms second, you will understand. The latest book, Yeshua, is very controversial. I noticed that there's a picture that depicts Jesus on the cross. But the Yeshua it's controversial because the question is what happens or what would happen if that was a hoax. There will be a lot of nerves exposed and touched by this book because people will want to, it was a man called Salman Rushdie that had a fatwa declared against him. Well, in the Christian and the Western society, we don't believe in fatwas, but Christianity can hold a grudge the same way. And I have no doubt that a lot of people will question and they will hold grudges. And I will be very, very careful in life after this. The conkeys and so on are getting cold, so I'm not going to spend too much more time. I'm going to pass the microphone over to the CJ and the other people here. Thank you very much, Alvin.
Thank you very much, Alvin, for that. I'm glad you didn't go on to read because then the others will get everything that is in there. And so once you, once you do that, everybody will get a chance to understand that. Reading is important, and selling books is also very important. You heard the story of the guy who was given Bibles to sell. You know that story? You know it? I won't go any further then. You know about him? So I went, yes, you do. Yes, no, this guy was given, they were selling Bibles, and people in the congregation, they took quantities to sell. But this guy outsold everybody. So when the priest wanted to find out how did you do it, he said when he went to the knock on the doors and he offered the Bible, he said, do you want to buy the Bible or you want me to read it for you? So they didn't want him to read it for them to buy the Bible. Go. So everywhere he went, he used to stammer a lot. So if he went to, and he asked, you want to buy it? Or I can read it for you. So he sold a lot because they quickly got rid of him. Charles Cook is a prolific writer and an accomplished musician. And Charles is going to tell you something about his book as well.
A couple of years ago, I launched my book of hymns. It's called Hear, O Hear My Prayer, O Lord. There are 131 pieces in here. And what's unique about it is that many of the hymn tunes, and you probably ask, what is a hymn tune, are named after places in Barbados. And that's the connection that you have in Barbados. If you were at the church service this past Sunday, you would have sung All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. Now that was sung to the hymn tune of Dadam, but the vicar and other people connected with the church didn't have that hymn tune name. They wanted to sing it to a different tune called Miles Lane, for example. So that's where hymn tune names are important. And many of my hymns are named after places in Barbados like Boscobel, Flagstaff, Bridgetown, Spikestown, you name it, in there. And I'm currently, this is volume one, I'm currently working on volume two, and I can assure you that basically all of the hymns will be named after places in Barbados. So you can come and take a peek at it in the library and see what the hymns are all about. I'm certain that you'll be blessed by the content of the hymns. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Charles started by saying years ago, and then he said my name was Charles Cook. And then I'm going to say, what is it now? We started with a lady, and now we're going to end with a lady. Lorraine Jackson, someone a distant relative of Michael and family. But she's going to tell you all about her book as well. Lorraine.
No, this is not my book. This is my brother's book. But my brother has some challenges with glaucoma as well as arthritic knees. He is currently in Barbados. So he couldn't be here to launch the book. So we launched his book at my sister's house on Saturday evening. And I want to thank the Consul General and his staff. They have been so good to us, so accommodating. We even had a representative from the consulate at the launching. We also had an eminent author, Tom Clark. He came and he spoke at length. And Bromley Armstrong, and these are all people who knew Carl personally. So let me tell you a little bit about him. And I'm not wearing my glasses, so he was born in Barbados. He went to Providence Boys School. He also studied at Ryerson University and Oxford University in England. He is a retired Foreign Service officer who was stationed in Europe, the Caribbean. And when he came back from Ryerson, he was a columnist for the island's newspapers, The Advocate at one point, and The Nation. And when he left the Foreign Service, he founded a public relations company. Now, he published East Wind in Paradise in 1981, and it sold. But my nephew had an idea, Eurita's son, and his nephew also. Why don't we bring this book into the 21st century? So 1981, the things that happened in 1981 are not the same things that you would have. The technology is different and the situations are different. So what Steve did was he went down to Barbados, consulted with Carl, and together they did the updated version of the original book, East Wind in Paradise. But they have not lost the themes, the characters, or Carl's crisp writing style. And Carl was instrumental in the editorial functions and the authorship of the book from the beginning. It's a political thriller set in Barbados. When you read it, I'm not saying if you read it, when you read it, you'll recognize places like Fustic Corner. And a Canadian was trying to say that, and he said, Fustic Corner. I said, no, that's Fustic Corner. Totally different. And you don't go to Oystens. Carl is writing about Oystens and Carlisle Bay. And Edge is the main character. He's sort of a James Bond type of person, secret agent. His main drink, it's not rum and coconut water. I will not read from the book because I'm conscious of the time, I'm also conscious of the goodies. But I'm sure that this is one of the first political thrillers. It's a straight work of fiction, and it's a political thriller. You'll enjoy reading it. You'll enjoy the characters. And the price is $10, and you can get a copy from us in the library.
We're here at the Consul General Office for Barbados celebrating their 48th independence. Congratulations. And with me, I have our Consul General, Hazley Benn. Thank you so much for having us today.
You're very, very welcome.
Now, I know today is a very special day. It's a kickoff of the Barbadian art. So if you want to just tell us a little bit about that.
Well, we thought that we will invite a number of Barbadians here living in Toronto to come and to display their pieces. That we recognize that there's some photographers and they're very good artists, as we've just seen the display, and they cover a wide cross-section of things. And I'm happy to see that they've included things Barbadiana, bring back the memories, they've called it art through the ages. And I'm inviting Barbadians to come through and to see for themselves what these artists have on display.
Who are some of the artists, in case some people want to follow up with them? Who do you have here tonight? You have five of them.
Yeah, there's Owen Leon, Leo Johnson, there's Courtney Boyce, there is Jules, he's there, and Mr. Reed, and of course Mr. Truder. These guys that have been living in Canada for many years. Nigel Pierre, that's correct. That's and right. These guys have had a vast experience in doing what they're doing. And I'm happy that they are able, that we here at the consulate can provide that vehicle to which they can display their goods, their talents, and let people come and question them, talk with them. It might inspire some young artists as well to get on board, you know. So I'm looking forward to this very week. It's going to be on display for the entire week.
Yes, I'm a very symbolic artist. Most of my pieces deal with symbols, and this piece is very symbolic of Barbadians leaving Barbados, more or less the diaspora of the island. The inner part of this piece, you will see this, the colors of the water of Barbados, which is turquoise blue. The red represents the blood of the people, and give you what most people go to Barbados for, the richness of the ocean, the beaches in Barbados. The gold, as I said before, represents the richness of the people of Barbados. And you would see the roots. It's telling us that we are still growing, prosperous, and lots of hope in the island of Barbados.
I mean, in some good, great work. I love everything that I've seen. It's hard to decide what is the best piece. I like the photography. I like the different art. Owen Leo Johnson has a different style from the others, very unique. But Nigel Pierre, of course, is a classic, I would say a classic Barbadian artist. He's been around for a long time. He has some beautiful pieces of the island. So truly a wonderful exhibit. I can't complain. My man here bought a piece. He's interviewing me about the art. So
yes.
I said Howard bought a nice piece.
Yeah, one of Wendell's pieces. It's a beautiful beach scene, Rockley Beach, and just happy to be here and see all of the beautiful artistry in Barbados.
It's a wonderful blend of different styles. I mean, there's several different styles here, and there's some outstanding colors in all of them. I think the diaspora is my favorite. That's a terrific piece of work, isn't it?
Mm.
But there's so many different colors here and styles. I've enjoyed it very much. It's a wonderful show.
Took 3 days.
Yeah. Did you take any breaks at all, or is it just like straight through?
I took some breaks because.
Like bathroom breaks?
Yeah, more than bathroom breaks to allow for some of it to dry. And then to continue wondering, okay, what am I going to do with this? Because I had no idea what I was doing. So as I started to design it, I took some breaks and then decided, okay, maybe I could put some of this foliage here. Maybe I could put this out of the school of fish over here and just put in some marks down and let it come together. So I really started with all the design and let it come together on its own. And then I was happy with the
spot.
These things I find really unique. These things are from some pod that grows on a tree in Barbados. After I was walking around in Barbados on vacation, I heard a noise coming from a set of trees. And they were making music as the wind blew them. And I collected them because they were just falling off the tree when the wind blew. And after I collected them, the seeds in it is what was making the noise. And I found out that they call this thing mother-in-law's tongue because of the noise it makes. So it's like a cousin to the shot tree, but it's not that big. It's just a small pod. And I found it interesting. The seeds inside were nice and hard. So I took them out, used this as like seaweed, or to make it look like seaweed, and then I placed the seeds outside because the seeds itself had some beauty on its of its own. So they look to me like red eyes, and hence I give the picture the name Red Eye Odyssey, something to do with travel and red eyes and getting that inspiration from it. Yeah.
What was the original color?
The original color of the seeds were brown. Yeah, more like this one.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I really enjoy doing this.
At that time, you had to sit down and draw these things for their correspondence school, and they would give you grades on it. When you get those grades, then the series of examples they were sent to you, you have to do them and send them back to them all the time. So you're doing your correspondence course with them all the time. They would mark the things and send it back down to you. So they wrote this note and tell me, Pierre, you should, not Nigel, you should consider being a graphic artist.
At the time, did you really know who Norman Walker was?
No, I saw his work. I know the sketches, the paintings he did with him looking in the mirror mm-hmm. and painting, which was fabulous. I said, good, I can do that. So that's no problem,
mm-hmm. right?
But for me, it was a matter of I want to be a cartoonist. At that point, for the Daily News, you could get in there and yes. do cartooning. But that didn't work. So after they told me that.
Well, let's go to this.
Yeah.
You explained yeah. here just now about what it is actually people jumping up.
Kaduma.
Right. So yes. Explain this.
This is on the road. So what I do, I photograph people on the road. And then I take people out from different places and make my compositions to give you a sense of heat and yet still relaxation at the same time. Right? And that's what I do. So it is a matter of creating a piece, it's not painting a piece, it's creating a piece. Now, sometimes when you start to create, something goes wrong. You have to put it down. You have to leave it. Because it's a flow. The brain, the fingers, everything must flow in order to get what you want coming off of it. So sometimes I lose it. Like one time I lost it for 4 years. Could do one earthly thing.
But you said you have this in color as well.
Yeah, I have this in color.
But the black and white color just pops.
Yes, because remember, you can see more color in black or white than you can see in color, you know. If you can read it, right? You can see there the browns, what they're going to give you.
It looks very detailed.
It is detailed. Very detailed. Yeah.
Now, you said you taught yourself how to paint.
Yes, I did.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you know what I used to do? I used to do some crazy things. I used to paint on cardboard, right? I would go in my mother's yard, dig a hole, and bury it. Put the date when I did it, and then 2 weeks after or 3 weeks after, we'll go and dig it back up to see what went wrong with my piece. And let me tell you, we can never paint like nature, because the fungus that you see on that is fantastic, man.
I've never heard about that before.
I was crazy, right? I was crazy, but I like crazy things because I like to do things that are not always there. I like to get into the painting. Sometimes I sit down for like a painting like this. If you look at this good, there's 16 different shades of gray on that. And I sit down and I mix every gray paint the night before I paint.
How long did it take you to paint this?
No, you can't say time. No.
A couple months?
No.
No.
It's a feeling. Art is a feeling. So I can do this maybe between 6 and 4:30 in the morning.
Mm.
I can do this.
So when challenge you.
But I would have had that canvas outside the house, painting it mentally.
You
did
channel
for months.
Finally, to put it
so when I look at this and I say, bam, bam, bam. It goes.
That makes perfect sense. Yeah. I never thought about it that way.
It's a feeling. Because you can go all the time in the world, you don't have the feeling, you don't have nothing. It's just gone. It's out of it. Now, the one over there, is some of the same people. Right?
Just took from here,
but I moved them around. Moved them around to show you the sunlight that is coming in there. It's coming in. Look at the shadows.
It actually does look a little brighter. Like, for example, when you look at this right here, this one particularly,
right.
They look
not only
a little
that,
brighter.
Look at the sun there. See, the sun goes like that. Now, the other thing you have to remember, you have to read photographs. Because you can't have a shadow here and a shadow there too. Right? It means where is the sun coming? So you have to read it properly. And I used to do a lot of retouching to the photographs. Like I would take people who close their eyes for Billy Allen, and I would open their eyes, put new eyes on top, and then shoot them again. I used to do that. That was fun.
Yeah, it is very significant that the political party, whose leadership
was responsible for taking the country into independence. It's the party that is in office now at its, will be 50 years of independence. That's very important. Yes. We're also recognizing that there are many Barbadian organizations. There are not less than 16 Barbadian organizations, school alumni, and many other organizations that have been formed here for a variety of reasons. And one of the aims for the 50th would be to bring everybody together during the social season, which I refer to the social season from September to December, mm-hmm. where the various organizations have their annual dinners. Mm-hmm. I'm hoping that we can eliminate that for the 50th and have one big cohabla pot.
That would be really nice, to tell you the truth.
Everybody will come in and yes. plan and have a huge celebration rather than have 15 different celebrations leading up to the 50th. As well, I'm going to be inviting a number of CARICOM people here. We have the Caribbean Council of Core. Mm-hmm. We attend meetings, and many of them celebrate. Trinidad has celebrated 50 years. Obviously, I'll be borrowing from that experience. Mm-hmm. Jamaica has been in independence for mm-hmm. a longer period than we have been. Mm-hmm. I will be borrowing from their experience. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure the others, like Antigua and Dominica and St. Vincent and St. Kitts, who are in their 30s, mm-hmm. will want as well to come and see how we organize for our 50th. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to be reaching out to the diaspora from the Caribbean as well, and inviting them to come in and let us cheer. As a matter of fact, I'm also looking forward, I like singing and music, and I'm hoping to have a combined choir mm-hmm. where we can sing the songs of not only Barbados, but the entire Caribbean. I'm really looking forward to that for the 50th.
And it's not, and I understand, and I applaud again for what you're saying, because it's always for Barbados, but it's more of a Caribbean community yes. is what you want yes. to gather in, because you want to bridge that gap too, like, as well.
Well, I'll tell you this. I will wish that it will bear fruit, because we talk about Caribbean unity. And these persons who live here in Canada have an excellent opportunity to demonstrate to the leadership back home
absolutely.
What unity is like. I mean, their children go to the same schools. They go to the churches, they meet at churches, they meet at people from St. Vincent, St. Lucia, Antigua, Dominica, Barbados, Trinidad, Jamaica. They all meet mm-hmm. at various functions, and they have that energy, they have that chemistry of coming together. We want to be able to demonstrate that togetherness so that the leaders in the Caribbean can sit back a little bit and say, hey, if those in the diaspora can get it done so well, why can't we as individual leaders and countries in the Caribbean do it as well? So I'm hoping for that unity.
Since you've been here for 1 year, what have you seen a change in WISE? You've been here for 1 year.
To be truthful, I've seen people become a little bit more excited about what's going on back at home. Mm-hmm. I came from a situation where I was a government minister. I had responsibility for agriculture and for commerce and trade. I have always been involved in marketing. That's my background. And I like to market the country. I like to market things of the country. And I've been talking about getting products from Barbados. Not only products like hot sauce and seasonings and food products. I'm talking about the arts. Getting people who are getting calypsonians and people who sing, who do music. Yeah,
it's the roots
yeah.
and the legend.
To come here yeah. and share yes. with their people. And I've been talking about that. I've talked about investment opportunities that are available in Barbados. Many times people who have worked hard here and obtained their pensions, they send them back home, they keep them here, and they're sitting in a savings or fixed deposit with low interest. There are many investment opportunities mm-hmm. that can earn more for people.
They have worked for their money. Now the money should be working for them.
That's correct.
And by selling that, giving that message, by selling that kind of concept, people have become a lot more excited about the prospects of ownership at home and doing things to help the country's development. So I've seen that that newness. Yesterday we had a church service. Our reports are that the numbers were greater than in previous years. Again, it shows some enthusiasm for what's happening here. I attend many of the functions. Mm-hmm. I'm busy nearly every weekend. I go to a different church every Sunday.
Sound like me.
And I go to the activities. I go to the domino sessions from time to time.
Mm-hmm.
That creates that spirit of togetherness. I don't want to, and I open, of course, the door of the consulate, of the residents,
mm-hmm.
for groups to have their annual general meetings, for them to have their meetings at night rather than come down to the office, because we do not, as a Barbadian country, we do not own any real estate here in Canada except for the residents. Jamaica and Trinidad, they own property here where their members can go and meet. So I've said to myself, I'd allow them to come to the residence and have it as a meeting place. It's not only for me to be living there with my family. I want them to be part of it. It's their house.
Yes.
It's the country's house. It's a Barbados house. So I'm looking forward to that as well. And with that kind of attitude, people will respect you more.
Absolutely.
People will embrace the things that you want to see happen for your country. Mm-hmm. And all redound to the benefit of the country.
We cannot leave here today without talking about the youth.
Yes.
Youth, the young Barbadian and Bajan youth. What do you see? What programs do you have here in some of the communities and organizations you have? What do you have? What are there?
Well, this has been a concern of mine. It's very important that you mention the youth.
We always mention the youth.
Because I have, that has been on my lips from the time I came and began visiting with the various groups.
Mm-hmm.
And many of the groups are 30, 40 years
mm-hmm.
old. I mentioned earlier that they're from the old, let's say that they're the Allen School alumni, Harrison College alumni, St. Michael's alumni, Modern School alumni.
They sound kind of old then.
All old scholars, right. The thing about it is that they went to those schools, mm-hmm. but the children came to school up here, they're born up here,
mm-hmm.
and the children do not have the same affinity to the school.
Mm-hmm.
And I say to them, you have got to bring the youngsters along so that when you become 80 and 90 and no longer able to attend these functions, you have to pass the baton. So I have been working with some youngsters. I'm right now looking forward to meeting with them before Christmas at the residence.
Mm-hmm.
Not over a formal dinner or anything like that. We're going to have some pizza and some other stuff.
Let them be themselves.
And exactly. Talk about the things that they want to talk about.
Yes. You know, that's the best thing you've said, in the sense that people don't really ask them what they want. Let them voice.
Yes.
And speak.
Yes. I was in Edmonton 2 weeks ago attending the Edmonton Association's dinner and their anniversary celebration as well. And it pleased my heart to see the parents.
Mm-hmm.
They brought their children and grandchildren to the event, and there was an equal amount
mm-hmm.
of young people there with older people. Here in Toronto, the proportion is 90% or 95% seniors, 5% 10%
mm-hmm.
youth. My intention is to spread the youth, spread the presence of youth among the organizations. And perhaps by 2016, when we are celebrating our 50th, I will see perhaps a 40% presence of young people and a 60% of the elderly.
Because the youth are very talented.
Oh, yes.
And their mindsets are very different.
Oh, yes.
Because
oh, yes.
the different things that intrigue them, that
yeah.
you know, not the alumni, the yeah. alumni days. So you have to work with them.
Well, they have a mind of, they can explore.
They can teach us so much.
Hey, man, of course. They can do some things that
they can run your office for you, by the way.
Exactly. They come in and in two toes, they know how to do things,
yes.
you know. And they're quick. They have greater exposure than we had in our day. You know, the technology there, press of a function key and they can find things. Mm-hmm. They read a lot more. There's more television. There are a lot more things to learn from. In our day, we just had school books and we scarcely had newspapers. Mm-hmm. We might have had a few radios and stuff. So that's what we're going to be looking forward to.
Do you have, so, you know, just before we wrap up here, is there a message that you want to send out to the community out there? Just look into the camera and send out your message.
The message that I wish to send to the Barbadian community is this. Let us embrace the policies and principles of our forefathers. Let us, with one accord, look to bring that what we call the peace of the rock to a level which we can say we are proud of our heritage, we are proud of where we are from. Let us now build a strong legacy that the young people can be can say, my mother or my father, my grandfather, my grandmother left this for me. I'm not talking about material things now. I'm talking about things that they can feel proud to handle and take the baton forward for their children and their children's children as well.
Well, I want to thank you, and that's well put and well said. And I know that came from your heart, definitely. And I want to thank you so much for sharing that with us.
You're very welcome.
And again, congratulations on your 40th year and you being here. And I look forward to the 49th and 50th anniversary you.
Very well.
So for everyone out there, you know, come in and join in the celebration, because celebration is just a one day. It's a whole year of celebration.
Right, you're right.
And like Consul General Ben said, his door is always open. So feel free to come in. Feel free anytime to knock on his door, and it will always be a pleasure, I'm sure, for him to see you. And on behalf of everybody and all the Barbadians and Bajans out there, happy 48th Independence.